Next is باب قول الرجل مرحبا. A man saying مرحبا, welcome. Now this is very, very different from the expression that we saw earlier. مرحبا means welcome, and this is from the word رحبة. رحبة, when it's used to describe a place or a country or a land, it means that that place is very spacious, that land is, very spacious, or that house that, or that building or that room or whatever it is very wide and roomy. So when someone arrives and you say marhaba to them, this is a way of welcoming them, meaning that you have come to a place that is very spacious. You have found a place of ampleness. So be happy. You don't have to worry about anything now. So it's a way of welcoming people. So marhaba is a way of greeting, all right? Not just welcoming, but also a way of greeting. And remember that it is not a replacement for salam. When you say welcome to someone, this doesn't mean that you don't have to say salam to them. No, first is salam. You say assalamu alaikum, and then you say marhaba, welcome. You see, when someone enters, a place where there are people already. Now, the person who is coming, who is arriving, may feel in his, in their heart that there's no room for me, right? Or that everybody, has their own, place, and everybody is, taking their food, or, they're talking amongst themselves, and now I'm the odd one out. Or I have no one to sit with, I have no place to sit in, I have no one to talk to, or I may be bothering them. So when someone arrives and you say marhaba to them, this is a way of, making them feel at ease, right? Acknowledging the fact that they have come, acknowledging the fact that they have entered, and then welcoming them into your space. So, salam and marhaba. وقالت عائشة قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لفاطمة عليها السلام مرحبا بابنتي. Aisha رضي الله عنها said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to his daughter فاطمة مرحبا بابنتي, welcome my daughter. وقالت أم هانئ جئت إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال مرحبا بأم هانئ. أم هانئ said that I went to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and he said welcome أم هانئ. Now consider the status of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and look at the way that he is addressing the women who are coming into his presence. One is a daughter, another, the other is a relative. And then we see that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's status is so much higher than that of the people around him. So, sometimes we think that it is only the young people who are to respectfully address the elders, right? But we see here that even someone of a higher status, right, they should address people of, a lower status than them with respectful words. Here, a father is greeting his daughter, welcoming his daughter. Marhaban bibnati. The messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is welcoming who? Someone from his ummah, right? Marhaba, welcome. And then we see that a lot of men, they look down on women, or this is what we think that masculinity is, but we see that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has no difficulty in welcoming his daughter, right, with such a kind, good, welcoming words. So when you say marhaba to someone, when you say welcome, this is, a sign of the spaciousness of the heart, that you're not uncomfortable by their presence, and you don't dislike the fact that they have come. And subhanAllah, we're the exact opposite at times, that we're just waiting for people to come into our space so that we can attack them. So people avoid us, they feel threatened in our presence, they feel unsafe in our presence, and they don't want to come. So the etiquette that we're taught is the exact opposite, that be welcoming with your words. Because when you will be welcoming with your words, then people will feel safe around you. So this is from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Marhaban bi binati, marhaban bi ummi hani. Now let's look at the hadith. حدثنا عمران بن ميسرة حدثنا عبد الوارث حدثنا أبو التياح عن أبي جمرة عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما قال لما قدم وفد عبد القيس على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ابن عباس رضي الله عنه reported that when the delegation of عبد القيس came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم قال مرحبا بالوفد الذين جاءوا غير خزايا ولا ندامة. How beautiful. He said, welcome to this delegation that has come, a delegation of people who have come غَيْرَ خَزَايَا without suffering any disgrace, وَلَا نَدَامَ nor any regret. Meaning, welcome, may you not suffer any disgrace, may you not be embarrassed, and may you not, you know, experience any regret. Because sometimes what happens is that when we go to a new place, when we go to, when we meet some new people, then what happens is that either we feel humiliated because people have, you know, insulted us or they have mistreated us, or, you know, we suffer, you know, some kind of loss, some kind of damage because of which we feel regret that, you know what, I shouldn't have come here. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam welcomed them By using so many words basically, مَرْحَبًا بِالْوَفْدِ الَّذِينَ جَاءُوا غَيْرَ خَزَايَا وَلَا نَدَامَا فَقَالُوا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. So they said, O Messenger of Allah, meaning they stayed for some time and they asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that إِنَّا حَيٌّ مِنْ رَبِيعَةَ وَبَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكَ مُضَرْ. They said that, O Messenger of Allah, we are a tribe of Rabi'ah, and between us and you is the tribe of Mudar. And it is well known that Mudar and Rabi'ah were, you know, at war. So they said, وَإِنَّا لَا نَصِلُ إِلَيْكَ إِلَّا فِي الشَّهْرِ الْحَرَامِ. We're not able to reach you, meaning we're not able to travel all the way to you in Medina, except in a sacred month, because the Arabs would respect the sanctity of these sacred months and they wouldn't fight with one another in the sacred months. So basically what they meant to say was that we're not able to come very frequently to you. فَمُرْنَا بِأَمْرٍ فَصْلٍ نَدْخُلُ بِهِ الْجَنَّةِ. How beautiful. They said, instruct us with a command, with an instruction that is fasl, that is clear, meaning give us clear instructions by which we can enter Jannah. Meaning just tell us very clearly what we're supposed to do so that when we do them, we will enter Jannah. وَنَدْعُوا بِهِ مَنْ وَرَاءَنَا. And we can also invite those who are behind us, meaning those at home, to the same commands. We will tell them to do the same things. Meaning tell us what to do by which we can enter Jannah, and something that we can teach our families also and other people back home so that they can also follow it and enter paradise. فقال, so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, أربعٌ وأربعٌ أقيموا الصلاة وآتوا الزكاة وصوموا رمضان وأعطوا خمس ما غنمتم. He said, أربعٌ وأربعٌ, four and four, meaning four things to do and four things to stay away from. They asked for clear commands, and look at the clarity with which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave them instructions. He said, four and four. What's the first four things that you're supposed to do? What are they? Establish the prayer, give zakat, fast in Ramadan, and give the khumus of that which you earn as war booty. Meaning the fifth of it, you have to surrender to the head of the state. وَلَا تَشْرَبُوا فِي الدُّبَّاءِ وَالْحَنْتَمِ وَالنَّقِيرِ وَالْمُزَفَّةِ. And what are the four things that you shouldn't do? Do not drink from dubba, hantam, naqir, and muzaffat. These were different kinds of wine vessels. Now, first of all, we see how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam welcomed them so beautifully. غَيْرَ خَزَايَا وَلَا نَدَامَا. So we should also adopt this habit, right? This culture that when someone comes home, when someone comes to visit us, no matter how surprised we are, and no matter how tired we are, and no matter how much work we have had to do and are doing and will have to do once they leave, still, when someone has come, we should welcome them. Why? So that they don't feel awkward, they don't feel rejected, they don't feel that we have insulted them, and they don't feel regretful for having bothered you. right, for having caused you inconvenience. So always welcome people, right? And this should be, of course, with words and also with our, you know, facial expressions and our, you know, our overall behavior. Now, of course, if somebody comes, you know, all of a sudden and you're busy in something, you can always ask them to come at another time. And this is mentioned in the Quran that وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَكُمْ ارْجِعُوا فَارْجِعُوا, that when you're told to return, meaning you go to someone's house and they're busy and they tell you to go, then go, that is better for you, that is purer for you. Meaning we are allowed to refuse someone from entering our home. If, you know, for example, we're busy with something and we don't want to entertain them at the time, it is permissible. However, you can also do that after welcoming them. Right? After saying, assalamu alaikum, welcome, you know, what a nice surprise. And you can, you know, have a brief conversation with them and you can let them know that, you know, I'm busy at this time. How about we meet at a later time? So welcome people, because this is, you know, the prophetic way. And we see, you know, in the hadith of Mi'raj that when the Prophet ﷺ went on the ascension, the Mi'raj, meaning when he was taken up through the heavens, then every sama, every sky that he reached, and he met a prophet of Allah over there. So for example, we learn that at the first, when he met Adam alayhi salam, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, فَسَلَّمْتُ عَلَيْهِ, he greeted me, فَقَالَ مَرْحَبًا بِكَ, and he said, welcome. مَرْحَبًا بِكَ, welcome you, مِنْ إِبْنٍ وَنَبِيٍ, that, you know, O son and O prophet. So welcome. Adam alayhi salam welcomed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Then in the next sky, Isa and Yahya alayhi salam, both of them, they said, marhaban bika min akhin wa nabiyyin. And then Yusuf alayhi salam, he also greeted him and he said, marhaban bika, welcome. Then Idris alayhi salam also greeted him and then he said, marhaban bika. Then Harun alayhi salam, and then Musa alayhi salam. Yani subhanallah, and then finally Ibrahim alayhi salam, every prophet messenger that he sallallahu alayhi wasallam met, yani first was salam and then was greeting. So this is you know, a habit that we should also develop. Especially when someone is arriving, you know, as a guest, or they're arriving, you know, from a journey. Or for example, your spouse was out all day long, and now at the end of the day they have returned, or your children were gone to school all day, and you know, in the evening they have returned. So salam and welcome, right? Not that, oh, you're here already. You know, subhanAllah, we reject people not just with our words, but also with our expressions. So be welcoming. And we see that the angels, when they take the soul of a righteous person and they take that soul up into the skies, the angels also welcome that soul, right? They say, marhaban bin nafsi tayyiba, welcome, o good soul, kanat fil jasad tayyib, that lived in a good, clean body. Subhanallah. The angels will also welcome you know, the souls of the righteous. They actually welcome the souls of the righteous into the heavens. And then we see that earlier we saw how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would welcome his daughter, right, this way, marhaban bibnati. And then we see that he would also welcome his companions in this way. We learned that once Ammar radiallahu anhu asked permission from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to enter, and he said, i'dhanu lahu, allow him, marhaban bi tayyib al mutayyib, welcome to a tayyib person, meaning a person who is really good. And then we see that the Prophet ﷺ also advised his companions to welcome those who come to seek knowledge. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu reported that the Prophet ﷺ said that certain people will come to you seeking knowledge. So when you see them, فَقُولُوا لَهُمْ مَرْحَبًا, say to them, marhaban, welcome, biwasiyyati Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, as per the instruction of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Meaning the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam instructed us to welcome you. And he said, allimuhum, teach them, meaning give them the knowledge that they have come to seek. But first, welcome them. And this shows us that it is also important for, you know, a teacher, that especially when, you know, a new class has come, then at that time, welcome the students of knowledge, especially those who have come to seek, you know, sacred knowledge. And then we see that those who are, you know, welcomed today, meaning in the world, will also be welcomed in the hereafter. There's a hadith in which we learn that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that when a person goes to a people and they say marhaba to him, then on the day that this person will meet his Lord, then he will also be told marhaba at that time. Meaning a person who is welcomed here in this world will also be welcomed in the next world. And when a person goes to a people and they say, you know, they're basically very unhappy with his arrival, they cannot wait for him to go, and they reject him, then such a person will also be rejected on the Day of Judgment. What does this mean? This means that, you know, your relationship with people really shows who you are and how you are near Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This doesn't mean that all people will treat you the same, no. But you should check what kind of a relationship you have with good people, with righteous people. That are they happy with your arrival, with your coming, or are they uncomfortable? Right? And especially think about it, that when you go somewhere, why, if people get uncomfortable, why do they get uncomfortable? Are they uncomfortable because they know that you're going to start criticizing them? They know that, you know, you're going to start, you know, selfishly just talking about what you want to talk about and not listen to them. Do they feel uncomfortable because the kind of things you talk about are hurtful? So, you know, sometimes we blame people for, you know, for our unhealthy relationships, but we fail to hold our own selves accountable. That if people are avoiding us constantly, then perhaps we need to look inward. We need to check ourselves, that is there something in me, something that I am doing? Is it that I speak very loudly? Is it that, you know, I can be very condescending? Is it that I can be very selfish? Is it that I can come across as very greedy? Is it that my body smells? Is it that my clothes are not clean? Is it that, you know, I have extremely bad breath? Or what is it? What is it that I need to change in myself so people are not constantly avoiding me? What is it that I can do? Because the way that we are treated by people, right, is a reflection of who we really are. And then I also want you to appreciate in this hadith that, you know, when the people ask the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that teach us something, give us clear instructions, why did they ask for knowledge? They said, teach us something by which we can enter paradise. Give us clear instructions so that we can enter Jannah, right? That's what their goal was. And this teaches us that when we are seeking knowledge, then our goal should be the same. Our goal should be to enter Jannah. Not that we, you know, are reading this, learning that, so that we can debate with people, so that we can, you know, impress people. I know this and you don't know it, right? I know about such and such concept and you have no idea, so I am better than you. And you know nothing compared to me. If this is the objective, then we learn that, you know, if a person seeks knowledge in order to, you know, argue with the people of knowledge in order to belittle others, meaning the intention is not for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then such a person will not even smell the fragrance of paradise, right? Meaning such a person will be removed far away from Jannah. وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. So our goal in seeking knowledge should be to learn things that we can do so that we can earn Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's approval. That should be our ultimate goal. So this is very admirable in what these people said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then we see that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave them four commands. They asked for clarity and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave them clarity. Four commands. Notice that he did not mention Hajj. Why? Because at this point, Hajj had not been obligated. It was made obligatory later on. And then we see that the four things that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam forbade them from was was drinking from certain vessels. And these vessels, as I mentioned earlier, they were for drinking alcohol. Basically, these vessels were of different materials.
like, for example, a hollowed out pumpkin or something like that. And basically what people would do is that they would, you know, pour liquid in it and you know, close it and leave it for some time. And what would happen is that the drink, the water inside or the liquid inside would ferment and turn into alcohol. So now there's two issues over here. The first issue is that a person would not know that the drink had become alcoholic, and he would drink, he would consume that drink without realizing that it had become alcoholic. All right, because remember that every fermented food is not forbidden. What is forbidden is when it turns into alcohol. All right, and when you don't know when something has turned into alcohol or not, then you're putting yourself in danger. So where there is doubt, then what do? You avoid, okay? Because the nature of these vessels, like I mentioned to you, that they were made of organic materials, like a hollowed out pumpkin, the nature of these materials is such that when you put liquid in it and you close it, it would turn alcoholic very soon. So this is why the Prophet ﷺ forbade them from using these vessels, because there was a chance that a person would end up drinking alcohol without even realizing. And secondly, because these vessels were made of organic materials, yani if there was alcohol in it and you got rid of it, the traces of alcohol would still remain. There was no way of thoroughly, you know, washing it, cleaning it. And this is why he forbade them from using such vessels. But remember that a vessel that can be cleaned out, then even if there was alcohol in it once upon a time, if it is properly cleaned out, then there's no harm in using it. Because we learned that in a hadith earlier that we studied in this chapter, that when people were preparing donkey meat to eat, the Prophet ﷺ told them initially to break the vessels. And then one of the companions asked that, what if we just wash them? And the Prophet ﷺ allowed that. So this shows us that, you know, a vessel that can be properly cleaned, then there is nothing wrong in using that, as long as it can be cleaned properly.